Sorry about that. So, and the first talk of this session will be given by Nina Voronova, and she will be talking, as you can see here on the title of your presentation, about full block beams yielding ultra-fast rabi rotating vortices. This is a work.
Let me thank also Guillaume and Dmitry and all the organizers for holding this event despite everything, and for giving me the opportunity to present the results. This work is joint with experimental group of Daniele Sanvito in Lecce, and the theory is also joint, was done by David Kola, who was the next speaker in the session, Fabrice Lassi and myself. So for an introduction, let me just say that polaritons, as any two-level system, are conveniently represented on a block sphere, which is often used for spin one-half particles or for polarization states, and this should be very familiar to you. Here we have the upper and the lower polariton, which are normal modes of the system on the north and south poles on the sphere, while the photon and exciton states belong to opposite points on the equator. So each possible realization of a polariton state of a quantum state is denoted here, which is a linear superposition of the two normal modes, is represented on the sphere by two coordinates, which are two angles, or as the same as this parameter S is the cosine of theta, which is given by the population imbalance of the upper and lower polariton, normalized with respect to the total population, because the sphere radius should be unity. Okay, and the phi, the azimuthal angle, is the relative phase between the upper and lower polarity states, which change in time due to rabi oscillations. This is the idealistic picture without any decay. So if you excite your system with a right pulse triggering the rabi oscillations, and depending on the energy of your excitation, you can get the circle, the rigid rotation of the state on the sphere in the upper hemisphere, on the equator, in case you excite in the middle, exactly in the middle between the upper and lower polariton, or in the lower hemisphere, if you excite closer to the lower polarity state. But in reality, of course, we have decay, and we all know that decay of the upper polariton is much faster than the lower polariton. So what actually happens when you excite is that not only the rotation of the state on the sphere is happening, but also the drift down from the upper to the lower semisphere until your system reaches the lower polariton state, and then the rabi oscillations are stopped because there is nothing to oscillate. What one observes in the experiment in this case is not any kind of circles, but just the rabi oscillation in the total field intensity, which you observe because any state which is accessible out of the whole sphere is a pure photon state, because we observe photoluminescence from the microwave. What one can do here is, for example, exciting the system with the two pulses. Depending on the delay between the two pulses, you can revive the oscillations or completely kill them. You can actually control what you do, like on this block sphere. Okay. Next, also should be very well known to everyone, you can use the same representation for the polarization, then it's called the Poincaré sphere. Here, all polarization states are placed on the opposite points of different kind of equators. And if you excite the system with the superposition of the two pulses, which have different topology, here I show the specific case when you excite the left circular and right circular polarizations with the Laguerre Gaussian beam, which carries an optical vortex with charge one and the simple Gaussian, then you will get the so-called full Poincaré beam, which means that every state on this Poincaré sphere is present in the space somewhere at some different positions. So you can do it exciting your system with any two orthogonal polarizations, actually, it can be left and right, can be right and left, as we hear in the middle, and can be also vertical and horizontal. In any case, if you do it, you create a homeomorphic mapping between the Poincaré sphere and the plane, and your 2D plane. But here, because there is no coupling between the modes, there is no rabi oscillations, this picture is static. So nothing is changing, neither on the sphere nor on the 2D plane. Now one can also combine these two Hilbert spaces and actually excite the exciton polariton system with two pulses with different orthogonal polarizations. And then what you get, this is a very nice work of David actually, what you get is you span the whole Poincaré sphere in time, because while drifting on the Bloch sphere, you change the ratio between upper and lower polariton because of different decays of the two modes. And as you see here in the simulation, I repeat, during time, your whole cloud or your whole spot changes polarization. So what is behind this work, which I'm going to present, is not exciting with different polarizations, neither exciting the Poincaré sphere with different topologies as shown in the previous slide, but actually exciting the exciton polariton Bloch sphere with pulses with different topologies. So what happens if we excite our system and look at the Rabi dynamics when we first imprint the optical vortex, shining the Laguerre-Gaussian beam, and then after some delay, we add the second pulse, which is a plain Gaussian. So if there was no Rabi coupling in the system, no Rabi oscillations, what would happen would be rather immediate, is that when we get the overlap of the two pulses, like in the case of full Poincaré beam, in the place where the like one pulse is uniform in phase, the other one has a phase which is changing. In the place where they are in phase, they will sum up. And then the opposite point where the phase are have a pi phase difference, it will destructively interfere. So what happens is instantaneous displacement of the zero point of the vortex from one point to the other. And the angular direction of this displacement depends on the phase shift between the two pulses. However, in our case, this is not as simple because we have the coupling between the upper and lower modes, and the eigen energies corresponding to the upper mode and the lower polariton modes are different. They differ by their Rabi energy. So in time, which happens during the arrival of the first and the second pulse, actually the upper and the lower polariton phase changes with different rate. Yeah, so what we have is the different displacement of this vortex point of the phase singularity in the two normal modes of the system. This is schematically shown here, and the angular direction of this displacement depends on this time delay between the pulses. And in terms of the Rabi oscillation period, if you shine the second pulse in half integer times of the Rabi oscillation period, you get something like what is shown here. The vortices in upper and lower polariton are displaced to opposite position. If you shine exactly in the integer amount of Rabi oscillation periods, they will be displaced in the same position and you will get a very simple case. So what happens here is that in fact, on our real plane, these two profiles of the upper and lower polariton, they overlap. And it means that shown here schematically on a cross cut that we at each different position in space, we have a different ratio of upper and lower polariton. And if we go around, we also have a different phase, which results in the following. Like here, you even see, I plot on the right axis, this local imbalance, by local, because it now becomes dependent on position, which defines the quantum state. So the parameters S and phi, which define the quantum state position, start become depending on X and Y. So by this, we create a homeomorphic mapping between the whole sphere and the real plane, because now, since every position in space is associated to different S and Phi here, this quantum state becomes also position dependent. And if we try to plot it, for the case of equal total populations of upper and lower polaritons, so I assume the case of this blue second case when we excite the system in the middle in energy between the lower and upper polariton. So what happens here, we can plot by stereographic projection of the Bloch sphere to the real plane like this. And actually you see that since this sphere also rotates in time, all quantum states which go along the white lines with the constant long latitude on the sphere start to follow the circular trajectories on the real plane here. And these trajectories are stretched due to stereographic projection. If we try to describe it mathematically, what is important, and I didn't say it, what is plotted here is, and given in the color scale, is the total population of the system, is the total density, not the photon density, but the total density of particles, upper polaritons and lower polaritons. So if we try to put it in some mathematical terms, we need to write the Möbius transformation, which is transformation, actually the law which describes the correspondence between one complex number and another complex number, and which moves along these circles and connect the sphere to a plane. So identifying quantum state with the complex variable Z, we can rewrite this Möbius transformation. And for the case of simple rotation without any decay, just Rabi oscillation, it becomes very, very straightforward. A is equal to exponent of I omega t and D is equal to one. However, in realistic systems, we have decay. So what happens actually here with this density on the sphere is that it should drift down from the upper state to the lower state. And then the coefficient A in the Möbius transformation changes. And what we get is actually something like this if we plot it on the sphere. So imagine we excited the system originally very, very close to the upper polariton state, and then the whole thing goes down. And at the same time, we need to look at the real space, which is a stereographic projection, and it rotates together with the sphere. Okay, so this is the trajectory of a given quantum state, given by a blue line on the Bloch sphere. And its projection on a real plane for different cases of different ratio of decay and the Rabi frequency. So here, what is important is that I play it again. At the time of the arrival of the second pulse, we create a so-called full Bloch beam, which means that we cover the full Bloch sphere. We realize that all states in this Hilbert space somewhere in space on the 2D plane. And then if we track a particular quantum state, it will follow the circle trajectories, which are called in geometry Apollonian circles. And because of the decay, they can grow, shrink, and so on. So let's look at different realizations. Here, excitation very close to the upper polariton state can be also defined by the global polariton, upper lower polariton population imbalance. And here you see the evolution of the trajectories of each quantum state. The trajectories on the sphere are given by white lines as equal to constant. But on the real plane, these white lines flow because the total density flows down and the stereographic projection also changes. The sphere tilts and it also squeezes or stretches because of the flow down of the total density. Now, the good question is that this is a full density of the all particles in the system, but what we observe in the experiment is actually only the photon state, so projection of this full Bloch beam on the state which is marked C on the sphere. If you want to write it in quantum mechanical language, it looks like this, but if you just plot this operation, you will get something like this, and the state which you can clearly track is this optical vortex, so the zero point of the photon field, which should follow this trajectory. Yeah, and it needs to be said that in fact, this is not a real vortex because there are particles, but just their projection on the photon state on the Bloch sphere gives zero. So the zero of psi c is not where the density psi total is zero, but where this projection of the state on your photon point of the Bloch sphere gives zero. So it's not a real zero of density, but at the zero of the photon projection. And this is what is actually observed in the experiment. You can track the position of the vortex, core by this yellow dot. It was originally in the center, and then upon arrival of the second pulse, it starts going with circle trajectories, which of course, because of decay, are of different radius. First, it is a large radius, and then it is small radius. Okay, so let's look more on the experiment, on this experiment results. We excite first with the first optical pulse. We see here the profile of the photon, photoluminescence. Then at the time of the arrival of the second pulse, the vortex is displaced and the Rabi oscillations are desynchronized, and then you see them again. And then they decay when we come to the lower polariton state. And actually, Lorenzo was doing this experiment many times, finely tuning the delay between the pulses, which tunes also the relative phase between these two pulses. And he was able to track the full bottle, to say, which is breathing with the Rabi period, and track the position of the vortex, which is covered, represented here by the blue line. And at every given time, you can see that it follows a circle trajectory, and though plotting it all together gives you a spiral. If you plot together with it an exciton vortex trajectory, which would correspond to pure photon state, you will get a double helix. Good, so also these results, which are observed in the experiment, can be tracked easily by the Gross-Pitayevsky, both with decay or without decay, by following the zero of the corresponding wave function. So if we do it, we see that the zeros of upper and lower polariton, which correspond to, like the zero of upper polariton corresponds to the vortex in the lower polariton, and the zero of lower polariton corresponds to vortex or in the upper polariton, because zero of lower means that everything is upper, yeah? And if you do the same for the case with decay, you obtain something like this. You see first here, the system is excited closer to the upper polariton state. So it first circles around the position of the lower polariton vortex, then the trajectory expands, and it changes at the point when the total population imbalance is actually 50-50, the trajectory radius is the highest, and then it shrinks down around the lower polarity state. What is important to see here is that actually, if we follow the trajectory, here you see the photon vortex core with the dark point following the white trajectory, the photon vortex core follows the phase gradient, and it is inversely proportional to phase gradient, which means that in the middle of the picture, where the phase gradient is highest, the velocity of the core which we observe is lowest, and in the periphery it is highest. So if you see in the place where the trajectory is actually going to infinity, the vortex basically jumps, it disappears and it reappears again. So it means that when the trajectory goes to outside of the spot, the velocity of the vortex core is very high. And if we track this on the experiment,
I'm sorry, I need to ask you to summarize to leave at least 1 minute for questions.
It's the last one. So if you track the position of the vortex core and follow its velocity, you see actually that you can realize a situation in which it gets superluminal. And it also is confirmed by the Gross-Pitayevsky simulations, as you see, but the reason of this is nothing unphysical. The reason of this is this projection of the full block beam state on the photon state, which means basically that this is the realization of the superluminal sister, where the blades of your sister are the upper and the lower polariton state, and the intersection of your blades is this projection on the photon. Yeah, so since I must to summarize, I will skip this last comment. Here is my summary. And I need to mention that this is work in progress. So we are looking in imprinting multiple vortices, moving vortices, and then we're going into the nonlinear regime. And I acknowledge my collaborators again and the funding, and I thank you for your attention. Thank you.
Nina, thank you for this very nice talk. The paper is open for questions. If you have a question, please raise your hand. I see Misha Glasov has
raised. May I? Nina, thank you very much. So as far as I understand, you model the dynamics of polaritons, basically taking into account the Rabi effect, yes, and the decay effect. And yes, you do it by making this very nice Möbius transformation, which allows to generate these interesting and understandable pictures. I wonder, however, whether these methods can be applied for more complicated situations and you need to use the density metrics. Because here, as far as I understand, you use the wave function and you just include phenomenologically the damping. Do you expect any difference if you would use the density metrics and somehow use more general approach?
Well, you see, I believe that the picture which we draw, let's say, in the block sphere in parameter space should not change. While the description, like exactly in the case which is shown here in this work, is fully linear and classical. As you see, it is modeled basically with Schrödinger equation. We don't even include the interaction because the experiment is done in the linear regime. But I believe that...
So it is very easy to check, yes, whether the density matrix would give you the same or not.
Yes, we didn't, but I believe that for this case, the picture should stay the same.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you, Nina, again.